to A14. This edition comes from the other end of the A14, from the county of Northamptonshire, and particularly the countryside around the village of Naseby. There was an outcry in the 1970s when the road was first proposed, as it went through the historic battlefield of Naseby. The battlefield area in the 1970s was still largely free of modern housing, roads and railways. Well, it was before the A14 came along, and it still crosses part of the battlefield today. Why such a flap about a battlefield site that was to delay the construction of the road for nearly two decades? It marks the site of one of the most significant battles in British history, the Battle of Naseby, on the 14th of June 1645. Some historians place Naseby third after the Battle of Hastings and the Battle of Britain as turning point battles in British history. Naseby was a decisive battle in the English Civil War. It turned the tide away from the forces of King Charles I in favour of Parliament. Up to that point, the war had been largely stalemate. At Naseby, the Royalist army was crushed and the King was forced to flee. But most of all, it marked the end of absolute power of British monarchy. Charles was the last British monarch to wield power without the consent of Parliament. Even with the eventual restoration of the monarchy, Parliament became the centre of British political power. Naseby was that one significant event that marked the beginning of a permanent shift from one form of political power to another. So on that day in 1645, who were the protagonists? Well, on one side was King Charles I. He was present on the battlefield, but his royalist forces were commanded by Prince Rupert, his nephew. On the other side was the parliamentarian New Model Army, under the command of Sir Thomas Fairfax. His army was a first in Britain, a trained professional army that appointed people to rank according to ability rather than by status or breeding. Its architect had been Oliver Cromwell. So welcome to Naseby and to the Naseby Obelisk, which is the site of the Naseby windmill where the parliamentary troops first spotted the royalist troops before they engaged them in battle in June 1645. At first, the parliamentarian cavalry struggled against the royalists, and the infantry struggled at first as well. But some successful tactical action by Cromwell, who was in charge of the cavalry, turned the tide in the battle. After defeating the royalist cavalry, Cromwell set about the royalist infantry line. 15,000 royalist troops died that day, for much smaller roundhead losses. This monument marks the place where the royalists drew up and commemorates their defeat by Cromwell's cavalry. The royalist cause was lost. The king tried to fight on for a few months, but was later forced to surrender. We know the rest of the story. Charles was eventually tried and executed. Cromwell became the leader of a republic, but it didn't last. The monarchy was restored in 1660. But from that point on, Parliament became central to political power in Britain. It was a slow process, but many of the rights and freedoms we enjoy today can be dated back to the killing field in Naseby, a turning point in British history. So what does the Battle of Naseby teach us? It reminds us that the rights we enjoy today, free speech, freedom to dissent, the ability to choose our leaders, and the freedom to hold whatever beliefs, religious or otherwise, we want to, have been rights that people have fought and died for. Naseby was one of those significant events that changed history. But what started at Naseby also grew through other battles, wars and great political events in the 300 years since. It reminds us to never take our rights and freedoms lightly, as there are always those who desire to take them away from us. Baptists were very much products of this 17th century desire to want to practice faith according to conscience and to also be able to worship, discuss and debate faith without fear of being arrested or persecuted. Baptists were associated with the parliamentary cause very strongly because the leaders of that cause also believed in this concept of freedom of religion. However, it took at least another 200 years before true freedom of religion happened in Britain. I often find people's perception of God to be something akin to Charles I, an impersonal, absolute monarch who forces his will on others without consent, and who rejects all those who dissent. Actually, the God of the Bible isn't like that at all. Rather than desiring a kingdom of unwilling subjects, he's a God of consent, wanting people to make their own decision whether they want to know him and come under his authority or not. God himself paid a high price in order that you and I might know him. This is what the Bible says about him. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Charles I paid a high price for a cause that was futile and an idea of kingship that didn't work. Jesus paid a high price too for his cause. But as a result, millions of people have chosen to follow his cause and come into a living relationship with God. And that choice is still open to each one of us today. Well, thanks for listening, and may God bless you.